Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Rock Bato here on Radio Republic, man. Thank you so much for joining us. To those guys that have been waiting since kanina pa, I'm telling you right now, if there's anything worth waiting for, it is this show, man. We have the one and only, the truest in the word, legend. This guy automatically comes up, man. Mr. Pepe Smith is in the house with us. Thank you so much, man. Rock and roll, that's right. All right. First of all, before we go, we start this thing, I just want to say, make sure you tweet us for all your comments. Make sure you tweet us at Radio Republic PH. Make sure you put the hashtag RockBato when you send those in. And send in some questions, man. This guy's an open book tonight, right?
Yeah.
All right, cool. And then you can also like us on Facebook at Radio Republic PH, right? I think that's what it is, Radio Republic PH. If you don't know it by now, then you're a loser. Ask the guy beside you that knows it and then, you know, get the facts straight. And then tomorrow, I'm actually going to be doing a set with the band Wolfgang. So make sure you tune in at live at 2299, right? And there's a contest going on. Sorry, Peps, one second. Take a photo of yourself reenacting a screen cap from the Sandata music video, which is the one where I'm doing that. We already have some entries in, which are pretty cool. So make sure you go to www.radiorepublic.ph to see the screen cap. Choose a line from Sandata to caption your photo. Post the photo on your Facebook page. Tag Radio Republic on the photo. And then we'll be, Wolfgang will be live tomorrow to choose the winning entry. So make sure you guys check that out. The winning entry will get an acoustic guitar courtesy of D&D Guitars. So that's pretty cool, man. Deadline of submission is tomorrow, September 20, 6 p.m. So send your stuff in before then, all right? All right, that's it. We're in. You're here, man. We're going to do this, right? We're going
to
do this.
We have to.
All right? Yes, we have to. No choice. Sir, thank you so much for gracing us, you know, with your presence.
You too.
All right. Are you ready for the questions?
Well, what else?
Yeah. Okay, so tell us about your childhood. How did your love of music begin? You know, so what was basically the start of all of this for you?
It was going to school every morning, and I always passed through the houses that are just, you know, like about to keep all their, you know, like sleeping bags and all that, or
okay. Beds. This was where? Where was this? This was
in Kamuning.
Okay.
Kamuning, you know. And, you know, like every house had their radio blaring out. And one such program before that I really dug was, it's old. I don't know if anybody would still remember this, but I think the dads and the lolos will.
Okay.
Johnny De Leon, you know. That's where I heard Chuck Berry.
Okay.
Reeling and rocking, and by the time I get to the school, he's just, you know, doing the ending of the song.
The song, okay.
Yeah, because the school was so close to our place.
To your house.
One block away. Yeah.
Yeah. So as you're walking, you can hear this song, and then exactly.
Yeah, you know, it stuck in my mind. You know, I said, "Wow, reeling and rocking." Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Reeling and rocking, you know, like.
So Chuck Berry was basically your introduction to the whole rock and roll thing.
Well, there were a couple of singers, like of course Elvis, the great Elvis.
Yes.
Some blues legends way back then, because this was the early '60s.
Okay.
We had Muddy Waters, John Lee Hooker, and all that, and a couple of black dudes who, you know, like. Elmer James was on the radio way back then. And also when I was going to school at Clark Air Base.
Yes.
I was always tuned into FEN.
Okay, yes.
Far
FEN,
East Network,
yes,
yeah.
Yes.
That's where I got my first, you know, bash with the rock and roll and blues.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, we moved down to Manila. That's where I went, you know, I furthered my studies. With the local school.
But I remember I was reading somewhere where it was like there was a point where you were like you'd see the jet planes flying above you all the time.
Precisely, yeah.
And it was like a choice, right? You were like, okay,
a pilot.
That's something I really want to do.
Right,
yeah,
right.
I want to fly a jet plane and just, you know, rock.
Right, right.
You know, and then music also was another thing that was like a balancing thing with you, right?
Right,
and then
right.
It was like. So what made you gravitate toward the music? What was it that just made you you know what, this is it.
Because it was just there. To be a pilot, man, you have to...
you got to study. There's a lot that goes behind.
Or you have to join the Air Force, right? Yeah. Which wasn't in my mind, you know, like... So it was always... The music was there. And way back then, you know, in the late 50s, Glenn Miller was always on
Glenn
the
Miller
SEN
Orchestra,
station,
yes.
Yeah. And so there was this little jazz, trad jazz, you know, that...
Peps.
Sorry.
That's cool.
There was this... jazz going on around too, and I absorbed a little, very little of that. That's why, you know, like, I'm not too keen on that.
Yeah, it's like not your bag of
always, cheapy. It was always rock and roll that knocked me out, you know. And they were the station that played everything that, you know, like they just released in the States, because the local stations here had to go payola and all that, right?
Yeah, so they were playing whatever it was. I was giving them, yeah.
Right, and you know. I was lucky because once in a while they'd, you know, pop in, play Chuck Berry or Eddie Cochran, something like that. Some of the rockabilly boys.
Do you remember the exact time where you were like, ito na to, this is what I want to do? Do you remember like...
Yeah, precisely.
Where were you? What was happening with, you know?
Well, I was... I moved to a local school here, and in Quezon City High School, that was a time when I was forming a band, you know, with my neighbors, you know, my neighbors and some friends and all that, and my PE teacher wanted me to join the basketball team because you know, like sayang daw yung height ko, all that, and I said. But
matangka.
Sir, sabi ko, pero sir, ayoko mag-basketball, gusto ko mag-combo.
Okay.
You know, and all that. That pag hindi ka na sumali sa basketball team ng school mo, sabi ng ganun, you won't graduate next year and all that. You know, all that.
Yeah, of course.
And so, you know, like I was going, to hell with that, you know.
But hindi na lang ako mag-graduate.
Oh, di ba? Yeah. That's why I never finished my high school.
Yeah.
I only went as far as second year high school, and then, you know, the call of the music was very, you know, intense and all
strong.
That, and so I had to sometimes, you know, I had to go to the principal's office to beg them to let me go because I had gigs around Asia, you know, like
oh wow,
like that was in Saigon, you know, Vietnam. And Hong Kong and Japan and all that. And so that's how, you know, like I couldn't keep up with my studies, you know. So
at a young age, at that young age, you were already doing,
thank you.
You know, you were already doing stuff.
Mm.
As in like touring and stuff like that, which
right.
is
right, right.
Wow.
Well, not really touring. It was more of work. Like you get a 6-month contract with this
nightclub. What's this, like a show band type thing?
Yeah, right. You have to entertain all these U.S. forces in Vietnam.
Okay.
Especially when we were in
UFO.
Saigon.
Yeah. UFO by U.S. USO.
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 Yeah, United States Organization and all that. Yeah, we did that too. And I remember there were a couple of dates that we did and... You know, like Bob Hope was there.
Okay,
know?
Yeah, because Bob Hope would be the host.
Usually. Yeah, right, for USO
yes,
too.
Yes, yes.
And they toured all the bases around Asia. And I met Raymond Burr. Well, these are old guys. I don't know if they still remember. Anyway.
Man, they'll do research.
Ask your mama,
research
your dad.
You, man. Yeah,
or ask your Lolo and Lola. Well, I'm part of that. I wouldn't hide it.
Okay. So you've always wanted to be a musician, like, you know, you can...
Nothing else.
Yeah. Did you...
That's the only thing I knew what to do. But.
So you didn't dream of doing anything else. This was it. Once the calling hit you...
I just nailed it there, and, you know, like, lam, lam.
Yeah. Which is actually a great thing, because a lot of us, you know, we don't know. That's kind of what our thing is. We don't know what the hell we want to do till we die. But
till our dad, you know, and mom, you know. Like,
yeah. It's
I want
great,
you to be a doctor, you know.
Yeah. Or you follow into somebody else's calling.
Right, right. True.
Okay. Who taught you? Now, was your first instrument the drums? Was that what you gravitated to at first? Or were you doing other things, Muna, and then you ended up
playing
the drums?
Yeah, I remember I was playing this school band. Well, it was actually out of school. Because some
cutting, nag-cutting ka.
Yeah, cutting lagi, di ba?
So, kids, stay in school, okay? But, okay.
So yung presence mo sa classes, you know, that bungi-bungi, dahil
yeah.
They're more absence than...
than presence.
Yeah, right. And so, I remember playing a 5-string guitar way back then because this was the time of... well, a lot of bands were using this upright bass, gas bass
okay.
Guitar and all that. It was designed from a gas tank. Of
okay.
A Jeep.
Wow, I never heard of that.
Yeah,
wow.
Really?
Yeah. No. Yeah. So wait, explain that now. What's that? How
you know, they put a piece of wood in between this. It's a fuel tank. Of
sounds dangerous.
Well, no, of course it's empty.
Okay. Now I get it.
You know, these are the ones that they put behind Willie's Jeep.
Okay.
They put them behind. You know, that's about this much square.
Yeah.
And then they put a that's about this thick. Yeah, yo, thick. And then they put a wooden handle, and then a slanting piece of wood again, and then one string. Just one string.
Yeah.
And I remember we were just doing the because most of the rock and roll then was doom 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 doom.
Yeah.
Red baby, something like that, right?
Yeah.
And so we were just fooling around, and from there on my music classes, you know, my music teacher asked me if I could be part of the group. And what I chose was the banduria.
Okay. Yeah. The banduria.
You know? But, you know, I was having a hard time with it. And then I saw, you know, by the side of the desk of the teacher, there was a snare drum. And it was a Ludwig.
Okay.
A Ludwig way back in the 60s, man. This was in, what, 61, 62, something like that.
Okay.
And so, you know, like I said, sir, I just want to learn that, you know. And then, you know, he told me, I think you better because the way you're playing guitar, you know, you can't play music at all. He told me, you know, I don't think you'll ever become a musician and all that. That's what he told me.
Yeah.
I wish he was still alive. And, you know, knocking his door. Hi, teacher.
Remember me?
And so that was the first time I hit the drums and all that, and I fell in love with it.
And it was just automatic. It was parang you were meant to do it.
Right. So I forgot the guitar a little and went to, you know, boom, just playing the drums and bashing it, you know, hitting everything.
Yeah. Okay. How were you as a student? I mean, going back, you know, we're trying to get into the...
Me? As a student? Lousy, man. You know, because, you know, I was always, you know, like... my mind was out of the classroom. You know?
So while you were sitting in there, you were thinking of what, playing music?
Yeah,
it was always music.
I'd
always
be looking out the window, you know, and then I just feel this.
Peps.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry. I'm gonna be like your mom scolding
okay,
you the whole time.
Me, yeah. I thought I was hollering, you know.
Yeah.
Anyway, I you know like dreamy eyed, you know, I'd be looking out the window thinking of this. Ventures or this they were the in group before the Eagles, not the American Eagles, these are the British Eagles, okay, the British Eagles, and then the Shadows, Ventures, and a couple of instrumental bands, you know, because you know we were supposed to have practice that afternoon, so I was looking out the window and then suddenly, you know, like the eraser hit me, you know, and then my teacher was going, Smith. The lessons are over here in this blackboard, not out the window.
Out
the, you know?
Yeah.
I was going, oh, I always get hit and I always get pinched. And all that because, you know, I was looking the other way around, you know, not at the blackboard.
Yeah.
But, you know, like one thing was even my Spanish teacher was so pissed off with me, you know, like, because, you know, there's 365 days a year. And probably I'd only be there for about 90 days.
Okay.
Yeah, it was always the last subject we had. So, you know, I had to take off and get to the rehearsals and all that, my band rehearsals. And so, you know, she got pissed with me, you know. well, what can I do?
Yeah, well, what can you do really? I mean, yeah, you go, you find your calling.
I really
you...
didn't need that school curriculum and all that.
Yeah,
because everything was just music and rock and roll. That
so
was
ever
all.
Since. Yeah. Awesome. That's awesome. Okay, your first band. Tell us how that was formed.
Oh yeah, like I said, they were neighbors and all that.
Yes,
and it was called the Blue Jazzers. I remember. We were playing instrumentals. They were like by Shadows and all that. We were doing parties, and we were using funny amps because you know, like we didn't have that much amps then.
Back then, yeah.
And so. Somebody fashioned a an old radio, you know, like
wow.
to become an amplifier and all that. And I remember, you know, like we were doing parties and all that, private parties, you know, just our friends. And you know, like there'll come a time when you know the radio just gets, you know, like
somebody broadcasting in, yeah.
That's embarrassing. Turn it down. but we had fun doing those things because there's nothing else to do, man. But you know, like sing, yeah. You know, make rattle, you know, noise, and you know.
What was the what? Why did you when you formed this first band? What was it to do? Shows, play wherever, parties, whatever, or just get your kicks type of thing.
Yeah, right. At first, you know, just to get our kicks because the parties that we used to play in before were mostly houses, you know, like birthday parties of this family and all that, and we're invited and all that. And I remember there were times when Saturday nights, you know, like my manager would put all his instruments in a big Jeep. You know,
yeah.
And we'd go around San Juan or Camuning, you know, like looking for parties, you know, to gate crash.
Oh, know? Really? Yeah, you weren't even.
Yeah, right.
That's classic.
We were punks when, you know, then. And I remember there was one such party. There were three bands playing inside already. And how are we going to get inside? Because we were listening outside. Hey, man. Oh, we can beat the shit out of
this band. They're not.
And so we talked to the security guard, and the security guard says, "No, what do we need you for? We already have three bands." I said, "We'll do it for free."
Okay.
Just that, you know, like, and then they you know, like, let us in. They called the celebrant and all that. Oh, okay, you can come in. Yeah, you can join. You can play you know, for people to dance and all that. And so that's how we got our kicks, man. You know, like
that's
raiding,
awesome.
Raiding parties.
Yeah, you just raid parties, go in, and then... So you would bring all your stuff in, go in, set up,
yeah,
on, or
right,
you just
right.
use whatever?
Yeah, and there were times when, you know, like, uh-oh, why? God, they got stateside instruments, man.
Yeah,
they're all imported, you know, that. Ooh, okay, let's wrap it up and go.
Yeah, let's just go.
You know, like sneak out.
Yeah.
It happens once in a while.
Yeah. Galeng. Wild. I didn't even know that was...
Yeah, right. Those were the days, you know. Like, I don't think they happen nowadays because, you know, like, everybody's so spoiled, you know. Like.
Well, that's true, yeah. Everybody's yeah. got their own gear and...
Yeah, right. And I remember we had to rent some amplifiers. There was one amp that I remember. It's Bell & Howell. It's for you know, like movies and all that, you know, like street movies and all that. When maybe a medical company would try to promote some of their medicines and all that, right? It's like a traveling medicine show.
Okay.
Yeah, and I remember we had to ask the guy, hey, can we rent that amp? You know, like we'd use it for band rehearsal. He said, okay, how much is it? It's 20 pesos a day.
Oh.
Yeah. And so those days, man, you know, like, that's cool, you know? Like,
yeah, really, of course.
You just to have an amp. And everybody's plugged in there.
The whole, boom band.
Yeah, bass, got the guitar and the rhythm.
So by the time you return it, basag na.
Well, you know, Bell & Howell used to make sturdy amps.
So it would last.
Yeah, right, yeah. Oh. Well, I think we busted a couple of speakers and all that.
I'm sure you did, yeah. Man.
Well, the manager was always there to, you know, like, pay for it and all
work
that.
Work it out.
Yeah. That was
Okay, here's this. The next question is, as a drummer, a singer for the Downbeats, you were able to open for the Beatles when they were here.
Yep.
What was that like?
Woo! I felt like I don't want to play anymore.
I'm sure it's nerve-wracking. Was that your biggest crowd?
Yeah. You can say that, because I remember there were, wow, man, a couple of thousands in there. I mean, you know, you couldn't move. Everybody was screaming, man, you know, blaring out in your ears, like I was going, oh, my God, Mamma Mia, what's going on? And you know, like all the teenagers were just screaming, you know, like screaking man, you know, like it was one high note kind of thing.
Yeah, one decibel whole time.
Yeah, right. And we were positioned right in front where the, the rope where, you know, the production is inside, and the audience was on the other side. And I was just sitting there, you know, 8 feet away from the stage, and we could just hear the natural sound of the Beatles. I mean, you know, like, because the instruments were surging, going up, you know?
Uh-huh.
And we were just, you know, we had that perfect place where, you know, like, we could hear each and every, you know, each voice, you know, like, if John Lennon was going to sing, there's no microphone and all that, you know, like, you can hear
You were
it.
Just hearing his voice,
yeah,
the actual
right,
voice.
Right,
wow.
Right. Okay. And I was going, my God, man. I don't want to play anymore. I want to go home and sleep, you know.
But was it, how was it when you finally got up on stage and played?
Well, we opened up for them.
Okay.
Yeah, and I remember Brian Epstein and Vic Lewis used to call me, you know, like, hey, yeah, you're Mick Jagger the 16th. The 16th, I was going, oh, yeah. Well, he's Pepe Smith of England.
Yeah. He's so. Right.
And you know, like they'd be, they were in air conditioned dressing rooms, of course.
Yes, of course.
And
what
we
was
were,
the vibe?
We were in the electric fan house.
Yeah. Sa tabi-tabi, sa atsaka.
At least, tigisa kami electric fan, di ba?
Oh, at least, di ba?
Hey, don't touch my stand fan now.
Huwag mong ilagay sa swivel.
Oh, di ba?
Diretso lang.
Huwag masyado malakas, pare, baka lipa rin ang buho ko.
What was the vibe like? I mean, I know there's, you know, like, you hear the stories about that concert, and it was a disaster. Not the concert mismo, but their whole visit here.
Yeah.
Which is kind of like a black
part
of our history, because it's the Beatles, the most loved band in the world.
I know.
And they hate our country because of, you know, what happened. What was the vibe like when they were playing? I mean, was it...
Well, when they were playing, you know, like, to hell with everything.
They
know?
Didn't give a shit. I mean, it was like, go, we're
doing
They just
went up there, and, you know, like, I remember the first song they sang was... when they were introduced, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Beatles. Lennon gets in and goes, bah, 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 you love me, here's some other rock and roll music. That's it.
Yeah.
And I was going, bah, that's it.
That's the stuff.
Yeah, right. And they were just incredible, man. They were just, man, I'm speechless for that.
Losses,
you know, like,
yeah,
man. And I remember, you know, like, there was a time when during the afternoon we were setting our instruments. I was still setting my drums. John, it was Paul and George. They wanted to pass through, you know, this little a passage, you know, like, and I was there, you know, hogging the whole thing.
Yeah, fixing your
Yeah, I was fixing my drums and all that.
Stormo!
And then he said, excuse me, could we just pass through? I said, oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah, go, cool, man.
And they went right at the curtains, you know, and they were peeping through it, you know, like watching, you know, like probably assessing how many fans they had and all and every time, you know, like, I don't know if it's the timing or somebody was pointing, you know, like every time they, you know, like spread
the curtain
the curtain, man, you know, like, wah! Everybody would shout there, and then George Harrison doing it, come over here. You know, like I was going, oh, these are the Beatles, man, you know.
It's so surreal, no, that they're actually there.
Right.
And then
I forgot, you know, to fix my drums. I was going, putres, ito pala tong mga to. Wow, you know. And then, you know, like, we had sometimes with them, you know, like, but everybody was kind of in a quiet mood, you know, like they never wanted to talk that much. And George Harrison, I remember, had this, it's a makeup kit, you know, like way back in the 60s. It's what all fags or, you know, like, how do you call this? Manicurists or it's a night. They call it a night bag.
I think I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
It's like that big
bag Samsonite
thing. You open it and there's like levels and there's a mirror with light.
George Harrison was teasing his hair a little, you know.
Yeah.
Would you like to tease mine?
Ako na rin, please. Now, there's this band. Okay, you were in Japan. You were mentioning earlier, right? You were in Japan for a
bit. Yeah.
Now, you were there with this band called Zero History.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And you were there doing these, what was it? You were like playing in cafes or something like that?
Yeah. We can say pubs.
Pubs and stuff. You were like during a tour?
And nightclubs, yeah.
Was this like another thing like the USO where you were
No, very different, entirely different.
What did you do? You got out, you just left the Philippines and went
We went to Tokyo and then we got booked on several clubs. Well, because, you know, like when you say clubs, they don't necessarily mean nightclubs or what, you know, like these are dance spots, you know, like...
Okay. What kai chan basta okay.
Young Japanese would go there and spend their early evenings and all that up till they reach up till two in the morning and all that, and that's their they call it Young Nihon. It's something like Young Japan and all that, you know, like they there's about, you know, two or three bands a night, and then we always did the last set and all that.
For the
young Japanese and all that, and that's how I met all these cool musicians there too.
But how was it? What was it? You were here in the Philippines doing your thing, and then you said, "You know what, guys? Let's just pack it up and go. We're gonna go to Japan. We get a ticket and go."
Well,
and bahala na si Batman when we get there. Ganun ba yun, or how was it?
Of course, it's prearranged and all that. How do you call this? A promoter would come here.
Yeah. Yes. Okay.
A promoter would come here and spot you and say, "Hey, would you like to play in Japan?" You know, and this and that. Said, "Yeah, okay. How much?"
Yeah, of course.
Right. What do we get? I mean, you know, like, so.
Yeah, we're not just going to go there for jockey shorts. But
And, you know, screaming, "Mommy!" every night.
Ba't kami pumunta?
Yeah. And so that was how bands got to Japan. And we were one of the early ones that went there. And because after a while, a lot of bands went up there and did so many crazy things, you know, like they were blacklisted.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
And you know, like we were lucky because we were the early wave, the first wave that went there. And
didn't have many rules. It was
go put in. And they were so accommodating. And every time we visited a sushi bar and all that, come in.
Nice.
You know? And they give us free drinks and all that.
Nice.
Until, you know, like in the 70s, especially around mid 70s, bands that, you know, like you can pay $10 each a month would grab at the chance to get there, you know, even if they didn't know how to play music.
Yeah. Just for the sake of playing abroad.
It always, you know, blamed on us. I mean, it fell short of, you know, of course, it couldn't play, and so it was you know, a rotten kind of thing, you know.
Yeah.
And so they were very vigilant about that, and so they had to screen all the bands that went there.
After,
you know, to be sure and all that.
And but, I mean, one great thing about this was, I mean, this is a big part of your history that unfortunately a lot of people don't know, while you were there... Uh-huh. There was this guy called Shinki.
Yeah.
Shinki Chan.
Yeah, Shinki Chen, yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Chen, sorry.
Yeah,
Shinki
right?
Chen.
Cool.
Who I guess kind of, I don't know, discovered you. I don't know if it was discovered you because you were already right? But, I mean, he said, "Hey, you want to join a band with..." And Shinki Chen, if you guys don't know, and you probably don't, but he was the Jimi Hendrix. He was dubbed the Jimi Hendrix of Japan, right?
Right, right. Both, man. Clapton and Hendrix of Japan.
Oh.
Yeah.
See? There you go.
I was going, so it must be Eric Hendrix.
Hendrix, yeah.
Or Jimmy Clapton.
Depending on
whatever. Moved well.
But I mean, this is like a great part of your history that a lot of people don't know. And I was looking up all this stuff. There's some amazing music in your career that came out of this, which was Speed. It was a band called, you ended up becoming a band called Speed Glue.
And Chinky.
Yes. Yeah. Now, do you want to explain why it was called Speed Glue and Chinky? Chinky pala?
Yeah, I think it's safe now.
Yeah. the authorities are far.
Yeah. Anyway, you know, like I was the Speed there because, you know, like I was... Well, I was fond of...
You were faster than everybody else. Let's just say that.
I was earlier than anyone.
Yes. You got there ahead of time before...
And the glue was my bass player because he was into glue sniffing, you know. It was funny, man. But every time, you know, like we get on stage, man, you know, like wham.
Yeah, it was like an automatic...
You're right. Yeah. It's like a team, you know, like... That was, you know, like a dinosaur team, you know, like was playing way
just
back
monsters.
Then. Yeah, mean, right. Like when we get up there, you know, you knew what to do. You know, like it was all for one for all, one for all for one in the band. You know? And so we, you know, like we really kicked out some some jams. And I remember Warner Brothers signed us in. With Atlantic.
Yes, you know, it was Atlantic. Yes,
yeah,
Atlantic
right.
Was the one
that was a Speed Glue and Chinky album. And
This was not Eve. This was Tiger.
No, the first one was Eve.
Okay, so Eve. This was Eve. Okay.
Yeah, with the three girls in front.
Yes.
And
which I think it's an awesome album cover, man. It's like three chicks that have nothing to do with them. And then it's just like...
You know the reason
Joey
why?
Joey Smith. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Because... Way back then, the immigration people very tight.
Yeah,
and you know, like they were making their rounds in the bars and all that. You know, like, well, for some reason, you know, like, well, Shinky, my guitarist, told me, you know, like, okay, if you hear, you know, somebody come in, this or that,
run, you
yeah,
run.
Yeah. You just sit there at the table, you know, pretend you're drinking. You know, I said. Oh, drinking my eye, you know, and you know, it happened a couple of times, and I was safe. That's why they couldn't put any pictures of us,
so that they had nobody to connect.
They couldn't see the three schoolgirls.
Yeah,
and they were in school uniform, right? That was Eve, because that was the first time we got together
and put out an album.
And mind you, Mabo, the bass player, came from a very popular group. It's like. Way
Dixie
back
in, Cups or something?
Golden Cups.
Golden Cups. Yes,
right, right.
Yes.
And you got a good mind there, man.
Yeah. you're coming on the show, man. I'm going to read that, pare. Oh, mag-research ako.
Ready to see you.
Parang ito lahat ng cue cards.
Yeah, with the computer nowadays. Yeah,
there's no escaping. So anyway, go ahead. So he came from a big group and then he joined you guys and then...
Yeah, no, let me reassess that.
Okay.
What happened was, remember I was talking about when we were playing in some bars and all that, we'd be alternate with some Japanese groups, right?
Yes.
And Chinky was one of the you know, best bands that I, you know, best guitarist that I saw there and all that. And I was so lucky because he was the one who approached me and says, can you play drums with my...
Yeah.
And I said, me? And this was on a break. My band members were in the club, the club where we played, and I just ventured outside, you know, like smoking some cigarettes, you know, and all that. And it was winter, and so I saw this ACB. That's what they call their something like band venues and all that.
Okay, ACB.
And a guy who works with the production and all that, Joey-san. Hey, you come in, you know, go up there. You know. That's where I met Shinky, and right there, out of the blue, he told me, you know, like, can you play jam?
Did he say, can you play drums and sing? Or was it just drums at that point?
At that point, he said, you play drums, okay.
Because this was, Eve was more, what was Eve? Was Eve more the psychedelic?
Yeah.
Or was it more the
psychedelic blues?
Yeah,
man.
It was psychedelic
blues. You know, like all I had to do was play. What we did was we played three songs. One was "Season of the Witch" by Donovan.
Yes.
But we did it, you know, kind of mixed a Donovan and Steve Stills kind of thing. Super Session by Al Cooper, Steve Stills, and who's the other guy? Oh, Mike Bloomfield.
Okay.
Yeah, those three. Right. And so we and then we went to Purple Haze, but somebody else was singing. His singer was singing. I just played drums and all that. And of course, you know, like, well, they dug what I was doing and all that. So he asked me, you know, like, if there's any time, you know, there's in the future, you know, like, I wish I could play with you and all that. I said, oh, me too.
Just
know?
Give me a damn call, man.
Yeah, yeah, right, right.
Motherfucker, I ain't doing shit.
Yeah. Incidentally, I think, you know, Julian Cope? Is that it? This guy, Julian Cope.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, he's this guy who, on internet, right? Excuse me, I'm computer illiterate.
Yeah, no, Julian Cope.
I'm just learning it now, okay?
He did a review.
Yeah.
On this album, which I was going to talk about after, because after Eve, there was still one more album, which was actually a
Tiger.
Double. Yes, which
the,
is Tiger.
The Tiger, yeah.
Which is a double album, which you produced, right?
You put that
whole thing together. I mean, it was...
Well,
from reading it, that's
me.
That's what
I didn't
I
know what was going on. All I wanted to do was, you know, hit in with the music. You know, and that was the time when Mike Hannibal was there.
Yes,
he
actually,
just
no.
In.
What? Well, from what I read, correct me if I'm wrong, but
please.
But your bassist, Glue. What was his
Mabo,
name?
Mabo.
Yes.
Mabo.
He split.
Yeah.
And you were like...
He was hospitalized.
Oh, was he too much? See what happens when you do too much glue.
Right.
Hence, everybody, you know,
I think his lungs
glue.
Got stuck up.
Really?
No. But
so he left, and then that's when you called in Mike Hannibal.
No, he was there. He came, and it was perfect timing. And I said,
can
hey,
you do the bass?
Yeah.
And then you also, you had brought in the whole keyboard. Or the piano.
Yeah. This was this guy. Anyway, Mr. California Maki.
let's call him that.
Or Mr.
Sushi Yushi.
Mr. Ramen. You
yeah,
know,
Mr.
Ramen was there. He was doing the Hiro. His name was Hiro.
Okay.
Hiro. I remember. I still remember.
Got
Hiro. H I R O. Yeah. It's not Hiro, okay? He's a hero.
Hiro.
But he was, you know, for that time.
And then, so you guys put together this album, which I was listening to it. I mean, you can actually hear it on YouTube, you know, because people are talking about this album, like, you know, like Julian Cope. He has a whole rating thing, and like I think this album and his rating is like number 15 of one of the best, you know, albums that he's heard. And in fact, there's another show. That it's you know how they have now these blogs that are like music blogs.
Okay.
And one music blog is called After the Sabbath.
Okay.
And they put out all these compilations of, you know, and this is a foreign blog, huh? This isn't like a local blog or
I know,
Japanese
I know.
Blog.
Yeah,
this,
yeah.
This is a foreign blog.
It was Papa Dom who turned me on to this. You know, like he told me one time when I visited him, he said, Peps. I got something for you, Piaps. You know, like he handed me a couple of pieces of paper and all that I think he scanned from, you know, and all that. I was reading. I was going, who's this guy, man?
Yeah, man.
You know, like,
because it's good music. I was listening to it and I was blown away. It's like even to this day, this music will still, you know, make the hair on the back of your neck stand, man. It's just so true. The recording, I don't even know how the hell did you guys record that? Was it everybody in a room just go?
The
it sounded like it.
Yeah, just
you
like
were
that.
All live, man. Let's just do this, you know.
The engineer happened to have graduated from Electric Ladyland Studios in New York.
Okay.
Where Jimi Hendrix was recording
and
all that.
Kramer and all of that.
Yeah, Mr. Aoki. I think it was Aoki his name. And he was the one who told me, you know, like, Joey Song, what echo? or delay.
Yeah, your voice is like drowned in all this stuff. Yeah. But it works, you know. It really works.
He pulls out, you know, like he motions one of the crew, you know. They were pushing this, you know, yay high. There's about 5 or 6 stacks of whatever. They're all delayed reverb and this and that and this and that. I was going,
you know, what the hell are we gonna do with that, man?
Shit. You want to bring us to space, man? Yeah, and really. All that. And he said, no, I just want you to know. And he taught me all, you know, each and everyone. Did, I was going, okay, I just want the echo and the reverb.
Okay, na yan.
Di ba? No. And so he you know, like, and then he told me about how he graduated in Electric Ladyland. He was telling me about the place where it's a small studio, but it has a 20 feet ceiling, and the whole ceiling was painted in how do you call this, black light paint.
Okay.
The whole universe.
Wow.
That's what Jimi Hendrix wanted. And so every time probably he was recording, no wonder he sounded like
that. Yeah, yeah.
He was going, and you know, like, and also, in one of the walls, there was this chain that all you had to do was pull it, you know, probably when he was sleepy, there was this bed that would, you know, like, pluck out of the the wall, you know, like, with chain holders and all that.
So it would just go like that.
Yeah, right. And I was going, oh, what was the bed for? Probably Hendrix, you know, when he just wouldn't stay. We want to puke or what? But,
okay, so back to your recording, though, uh-huh. that album. So you guys were all just in the room, go?
Yeah. Of course, it would always be the drums and the guitar. It would always be the drums and the guitar. Like the minus one, the first batch, you know, mm-hmm. bass, drums, and
guitar,
yeah, rhythm tracks,
yeah,
and then you know, like
you would come in later,
yeah.
Well, it doesn't sound vocals. Like it, man. It sounds like you're just singing while playing the drums. This album, I'm not even joking. You gotta listen to it. Check it out on YouTube. It's called
Speed Glue,
and Shinky.
Yeah.
There's actually another album called Shinky and Friends. You weren't involved.
No, I didn't. Yeah, yeah.
But I mean, it's good also. But I mean, this one, especially the one, it's you can't miss it. There's a giant yellow thing with a tiger on it. Yeah, and it's
a bubblegum tiger.
Yeah, it's great, man. It's really
thank you.
So, and that's really surprising to me. I just have to say that again because this is something about your history that I think a lot of people have missed out on. You know, I mean, I'm sure that the true fanatics for your career and all of that, they know about it, but a lot of people out there don't, and this is something that you shouldn't miss on because it's really good. So check that out, please, as soon as possible. In fact, do you have a copy of that, man? Can I have one? What the hell?
I wish I did, man. Me myself, I don't have any, you know, like I know.
Ain't that the way it always is,
I'll find one. I'll find one.
Yeah, okay. I'll hold you to that. I'm supposed
to have one, but you know, like
you should.
Rock and roll.
Awesome, pare. Awesome. We're getting some great insights and information. This is really awesome, Pare. For me, especially, man. Such an honor having you with us, Pare.
Thank you so much.
So, okay, back to this thing we were talking about, you know. And actually, outside, we were talking about the whole recording thing, diba?
Yeah. Now,
how, with the technology nowadays, it makes it easier to record, but apparently you kind of lose the whole live aspect, right?
The attitude and the substance, you
yes.
know?
I mean, the little niches that make it not perfect, but right. make it alive, or you know, make it
cranking.
Juicy.
It's you know, cranking, yeah. you know, and all that, and
like you were saying, the bass, yeah, well, like after the note is hit, you know, the rattle of the
string, right, and the speaker, you know, like you couldn't hold it anymore, yeah. you know, and.
Do you miss that? I mean, like, do you listen to music nowadays? Do you still listen to bands and music? And like, do you listen to the radio?
It's all compressed.
Yeah.
You know, that's how digital it is, right?
Yeah.
Let's agree on that, because I'm kind of an analog guy, okay? Yeah.
You're an analog guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because, like I said, you know, I'm computer illiterate, and then I'm just getting the hang of it now, God damn it. You know?
Okay.
even when I record nowadays, like the last one I did, Idiosyncrasies.
Idiosyncrasies.
Yeah. I told the late Dondi Ledesma. He was the one who engineered all this.
Yes,
you know.
He did.
If not for him, I wouldn't have that album. You know, like, thank you, bro. I'll see you there sometime. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I asked him, you know, like, is there any way we can do it? You know, just like, you know, like in a, because we all did this in his room, just that little room that he had, you know.
Okay.
And we used drum machines and all that. And by the way, those people who was asking on my Facebook and all that, why we use a drum machine when I can play drums, you know, like. How in the hell can you fit a drum set in that little room?
Yeah.
You
know? It was by
God
necessity.
Damn, you know? If you wanted to pay for it, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
If you want to pay for
next
it, go
time,
ahead. I'll yeah, next time I'll be happy. But not anymore because I can't play drums anymore.
Was that an enjoyable process for you, idiosyncrasies?
Yeah, right. And it was only me, June, Lupito,
yes,
and Dondi. And we just, you know, like routine thing, you know, like. Okay, do this, do that, you know.
Did you have the songs written when you went in there, or was it
no,
more like
not
just
at
went
all.
In and okay, we'll just
not at all.
Did you write it on the spot? No.
When I was, you know, like dubbing the vocals, you know, like I was, you know, like cramming right on the edge of the other side of the room, and you know, like okay, so I'd sing it, and then somebody else would write it, because I couldn't, you know, get, you know, like follow it, you know, and all that, and so we were. I was, you know, like pulling it out from
the sky.
Yeah, right. And Dondi would motion me to say, you know, like take and all that. You know, like we were doing this the first time digital,
okay,
because he was so good at it. You know, like the guy won a lot of prizes from, you know, like all these internet contests in the States. You know, like the judges were Steve Morris.
Wow.
Of, yeah. And I think it was, who's this guy? Anyway, there were a couple of them, you know, like.
He'll put it on his Facebook page when he remembers the name. He'll write it down and look it up.
Yeah, and it didn't matter to me, but it was for him, you know.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
They'd send him two bass guitars, you know, brand new from Music Man, you know, for his prize and all that. And about three boxes full of softwares and all that, and so that's what he used for our recording.
Okay.
And he knew everything, you know, like binary or whatever, you know, like, and he made it sound like, you know, like it was imported and all that.
Dondi Ledesma.
Yeah.
For you guys who don't know, is one of the great bass players.
Man, yes.
In this country, he's done a lot, and yeah, he recently passed away.
Yeah.
I mean, how long
ago
was it?
This was in 2008, I think, or nine,
yeah,
something like
about
that.
Like that. And he's another one, you know, that's
really
gonna be missed.
I know.
But
yeah
he
up
had
to this day, I really miss him, man. You know, like there are times when, you know, like I read or something like that. I, you know, somebody mentions his name and all that,
and all the memories go, come
boom,
back.
Yeah. Because for me, he was the best. He was really the best, man. You know?
He was a silent guy, but
yeah,
he did his thing.
You talk about something, man, you know, give me a bass guitar and I'll show you what it is.
Yeah.
You know, but he was always quiet. I always told him, you know, like, there's no cure for, you know, like how do you call this? Being silent and all that, because, you know, people would like to know how you are, you know, and all this and what you are. And he'd go, okay, give me a bass.
Give me a bass, I'll let them know. That's how he would talk, man. Yeah, really.
And he'd play. And he's very good at all these recording, I mean, you know, digital recording and all that. And I asked him, you know, like if he could do it in analog. He said, yeah, we could. So he, you know, he pulled in a mini, it's a junior double stack Marshall, 50 watts.
Okay.
Okay, half of the Big Brother, okay? And you know, like you just put microphones in front of it and all that. It sounded yay, just like, you know, like you were in a studio way back in the 70s.
Yeah. Wow.
And you know, like that's how he mixed it all. And the drums that he put there, you know, like I was telling him, you know, like, putres, Dondi, baka bugbugin tayo ng mga drummer dahil yung mga ginawa mo dyan, the way, you know, the one that you programmed, man,
yeah,
you know, like, yeah, like, it sounded like Kama Sutra was playing, you know, like six-armed.
Yeah.
You know, like I was going on, and he said, no, hayaan mo sila magkapa.
Yeah, bahala sila, tangin na nila.
Yeah, we were having so much fun in his room. Yeah.
And I wish I was a fly on the wall in that recording, man.
You were, man, but you were sleeping.
Yeah, I was sleeping.
You were drunk.
Okay, well, let's go back to this whole thing we were talking about earlier with the band in Japan and all.
Uh-huh.
This band, Speed Glue and Shinki, you actually got the opportunity to open for a lot of big name bands, man. You did you did Free, which is one of my favorite
bands.
Come
to think of it, nowadays, you know, I was going, God, I never thought that I had a great time way back then, you know, I was telling myself, just myself, inner self, you know, like I was going, shit, man, that was, you know, job well done. I mean, you know, I never thought that, you know, like,
Pink Floyd,
and nobody
man.
Knows about it here.
Yeah, siempre, exactly.
They didn't know about it, you know. We opened up for Grand Funk when they were there at the Komagegijo Stadium.
Mm-hmm.
And then we played Pink Floyd. We opened up for Pink Floyd. Buffy St. Marie, 1910 Fruit Gum Company.
Wow.
This was this band that was playing bubblegum music.
Yeah.
But when they played there, they just finished a contract with their management
so
and their production.
They became metal all of a sudden or something.
I mean, you know, I was going, oh, Dad, what's this?
What
you know, wow. You know?
Yeah.
1910 Fruit Gum Company. Remember the song? Chewy, 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 and about yum, yum, yum. I was going, and they didn't even sing those.
Bring out the lean nuts, bring out the corn nuts, bring out the lean,
something like that. They never played any of their songs.
Oh, yeah.
They just did new set, you know.
It blew you guys.
Yeah, I was going, wow, man, if this could happen, man.
Did you ever meet any of these guys? Or was it more like a.
Of course, you know, backstage, you know, you bump into them and all that, you know, like, hey, I'm from this and that. And that. Oh, okay. And even, you know, Pink Floyd, they were playing pinball, you know, and it just so happened that we passed through that area.
Yeah.
And the producer said, this is your table here. And right next was the Pink Floyd stable and all that. It was going, ooh, whoa,
yeah.
Roger Waters, man. Bang, bang, you know, like we were motioning, just joking around. Like,
yeah.
Pew, pew. I was stoned on acid that time. Shit, man. I was going, oh.
Your history is awesome. Awesome. Okay, so we're moving on past the whole Japanese thing. So you actually did the Tiger album.
Uh-huh.
You had Mike Hanapol there. And then after that, you guys moved back to Manila.
No. Right after that, I went to Europe, London.
Sarap ng buhay nito, grabe naman.
Di ko nga akalain eh. I didn't feel it then. It's only now that I'm feeling it.
Tapos na dito sa Japan, Europe na muna. Kita-kita lang tayo sa uno, okay? Sige. Okay, so you went to Europe. What were you doing there? You just vacation, see the sights, all that stuff, or
that time
you
I had
music
this,
again?
My girlfriend was one of the models of Kansai Yamamoto way back then.
Okay.
And she was, they called her Julie London because, you know, like Juri Rondon. You know?
Yeah, Juri Rondon.
In Japanese, right? But she was doing modeling for Kansai and also for Goros. Goros was the guy who makes all these leather craft, you know, all this pants in leather and deer skin and all that. And they're highly priced in Japan and all that way back then. And he'd, you know, throw in a couple of stitches of, you know, red fox. Red foxes around, you know, like you got foxtail in your.
Oh wow!
Yeah, yeah, and they loved it in London, you know. that time she had to do modeling in London, so you know I tagged along, you know, like it was her show, it was her thing, and so I just, you know, like while she was doing her thing, I was going at Kensington Market, you know, like all the fashion and all
that.
I was going
checking out the scenes.
Yeah, right. And also Rainbow Theater. I saw a couple of you know, like acts there, like.
So when did you decide to go back? When did you decide to go back home to the Philippines and say, you know what, I'm gonna start another band? How did that work actually? Did you say, you know what, I'm gonna go back, I'm done with this shit, I'm gonna go back to the Philippines, I'm gonna start a band, and we're gonna play rock and roll.
Actually, I didn't want to go back yet. You know?
Okay, all right. I don't blame you, man. You got a model. You're in Europe.
No, it's not only that. You know, it's the music scene, you know, like...
In London and in Europe and all of that.
Especially when I stayed with Paul Rogers and The Free, you know.
You stayed with Paul Rogers and...
Okay, let's rewind
me
a
away.
Little.
Parang ano. Okay. Wow, okay, go. Okay. How did that work?
Because one of my buddies in Japan was this guy called, his name was Tetsu Yamauchi. He was a bass player for the Samurais. It was a very popular Japanese band that toured Europe too. And we always, you know, bumped into each other without, you know, no reason at all. And so, yeah. You know, like we thought that, you know, like one day, you know, like let's get together and, you know, bass and drums, you know, like we always do that in the afternoon.
Jamming.
Yeah, just jam lang, you know, get the itches out.
Yeah.
And all that. So, and then...
kick out the jams.
Yeah, right. That's it. And there was a time when, you know, like he had to go back to London because I think, well, the bass player for Free then, you know, like, all right now,
yeah,
right?
Baby, it's all right.
Yeah.
We're gonna break out into song. Yeah.
Trivia.
Yeah. Trivia.
Anyway, Andy something, Andy whatever his name is, the bass player Free broke off from the band, and so they got him in because he was always jamming with them for some time, and during that time, that's when I get to fly to London and all that, and he was staying with The Free because they were doing an album.
Yeah.
The last album that they did was Heartbreaker, right? Remember?
Yes.
And then during that time, he did a little session with Rod Stewart and Uriah Heep and all that, and I got to meet all those guys in their pad.
Wow.
They were living somewhere in Reading. And so, you know, like, there was a day when one morning we're having breakfast and, you know, like, we heard a ringing of a, you know, like a bicycle bell.
Yeah,
bicycle bell, right? And I said, oh, it's Mick Fleetwood, you know, the monster, right. You know, yeah. They were going like that. And I was going, Mick Fleetwood, that? Fleetwood Mac, yeah. You know, going, and he was borrowing a cup of sugar, you know.
so it happens to rock stars too, huh?
Yeah, because that, I found out later that the Reading area, a lot of bands bought farms and all that around that area.
Yeah,
so
yeah, yeah.
They were about a couple of miles, you know, out, you know.
Between each.
Right. And so, you know, I had the chance to, you know, like talk to him, and they were doing that album,
Fleetwood Mac.
Yeah, they were doing this album.
They were still blues back then. It was still
right. Then Play On.
Green.
Then Played On.
Yeah,
that's the title of the album. You know, and also I met this other guy who was a member of they became Jethro Tull after.
Ian Anderson.
No, not him. Mick Abrahams.
Okay.
Bloodwind Pig, okay.
Bloodwind. I have idea what Bloodwind Pig is. But okay, go ahead.
Well, I saw them at Speakeasy when they played there too with 10 years after.
Okay.
Anyway, he became a good friend of mine and also Gentle Giant. His name was Rick. He plays keyboards for Gentle Giant. It's something like a futuristic kind of like Pink Floyd.
Mm-hmm.
They're very space and all that, you know.
Hawkwind.
Yeah.
Style. Okay.
Something like that, right? Yeah. Hawkwind. Yeah. And we were all at this island recording studio where the last album of Free was being done.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember one session was Because the early sessions that I was there, about four sessions, I was surprised that Paul Kossoff, the lead guitarist, was in California with his girlfriend and all that. And I remember one day when you know, like, hey, somebody's got to pick him up from the airport, you know, Heathrow and all that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So somebody went out. And then, you know, we were having some fun in there. And I remembered immediately this. There were a couple of guys who came in. I was so stoned, man, out of my mind, you know, like, because I brought in some sake from Japan, yeah. Okay, and they were, you know, like making usually the rounds of you know, Pakistan hash.
Okay,
I was going, ooh, yeah, yeah, and then, you know, in came the guys from traffic, like Steve Winwood
Jesus
was there.
Christ,
you know, I was going, my God, hey, somebody. Somebody pull my leg, man, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I couldn't move, man, you know.
Yeah, man, for sure.
Wow, you know, all these guys were there, you know. And then they invited me over to the second floor because the Island Recording Studio in Basing Street, they were doing their album Low Spike of High Heeled Boys.
I love that album.
Man, I kept pissing on my pants, man. You know, I was going, you know, yeah. You know, like, excuse me. Yeah, excuse myself, you know, like can I hit the bog? Yeah. That's where I learned it from.
Is that
what they called it? The bog, you know. Bog is like a, what do you call this?
Water.
Yeah, thing, right, you know, right. Swamp.
Like a swamp, yeah.
Like exactly, a swamp, yeah. Right?
Yeah, Pepe goes canina on our break. He's like, can I hit the bong? And I was like, what are you, the bong? What are you asking?
Yeah, no, you're saying the bong. Yeah, hey, bong, I don't do that.
Sorry.
No good, huh? Don't do
so
that.
So wait, back to this then. Yeah. So finally you leave England. I'm guessing after England, that's when you came back home, right?
Uh-huh.
And then what was this?
I went back to Japan first.
You did more music. And then, so when did you finally decide I'm going back home and I'm going to form a band and... I'm trying to get to the start of Juan de la Cruz. Where did this start? And before Juan de la Cruz, there was nobody playing Pinoy rock.
Right.
So to speak, right? Everything was either you're doing a cover song of somebody from...
Precisely.
You know, and you're not getting played on the radio, right?
No. There was not even any Pinoy rock in rhythm then.
Okay.
Because that started with us too, you know?
Yeah. So you guys came back, or you came back, and then what? You hooked up with...
This was in 72, I remember. This is when they, not yet, because September 21, I came back around, was it March or May of 72, and then martial law was proclaimed the 21st of that, September 21. Yeah, that ugly day, man, you know, like, I was supposed to leave that day, and I couldn't go home. And I was somewhere in the Hilton Hotel in United Nations Avenue when they were still there, because now they moved, right? Anyway, me and a couple of actors and actresses, you know, were in the room.
Because that was just some hotel. So
I'm not going to mention names and all that.
Yeah, but, don't.
If ever they're listening, all that, but it was. Ooh. I never even felt the bullets, man. I could bite the bullet, you know. And I was, you know, like right in the morning, about early morning. My flight was at 3 in the afternoon, 10 o'clock in the morning, and I woke up. I said, oh, man, it's my flight today. I couldn't get, you know, home on time to get my luggage and all that because
from
the
where?
Traffic.
Where was this? This was here.
Yeah, United Nations Avenue.
Yeah, you were going to?
Kamuning, from there. You had to pass through Malacanang, man.
Yeah,
it was barricaded, and so you had to do this, you know, like
take another route. Esquinita, yeah, okay.
Yeah, and so... There was no, you know, like the taxi driver that I was, you know, in, and he was going, sir, mukhang aburido kayo. Sabi ko, and I told him, you know, like, oh, may flight pa ako, wala stress mamaya, ganyan, ganyan. Flight to saan? Ano? Sa Japan, sa Tokyo. Hindi ho kayo matutuloy niyan. Ano hindi matutuloy? Kompleto na ticket ko, ganun. May travel ban ho ngayon.
So, wala.
You know, I was going, hey,
so, ba't ako nandito sa...
I just sunk, man, you know, in the seat.
And then, so what happened after that? That's when after you that, went man, back you know, home and you were like, okay, I'm going to stay here and form a band.
Not even that. You know, like, I just wanted to go back there, you know, like, because...
Well, I don't blame you.
Those days, you know... That time, you know, like, I always wanted to work outside.
Yeah.
of the country and then come back and have a good time, you know, like a, you know, rest, R&R, oh, you had all the bucks and all that, you know. And this time, you know, like, uh-oh, it looks like I'm going to be nailed here, you know.
Yeah.
So that's what I did. I just went, made my rounds around town. I didn't really dig anything what was happening, so I went to a Longapo, you know, but even before that, I was in the Longapo then.
Yeah, yeah.
I connected with some old friends and all that, and we, you know, we jammed and all that, I even jammed with Resi Pabunan's band, you know, the Maria Cafra for
a
month and all that, and also, you know, like all these sailors and all that, they were really goo-goo over rock and roll, you know, like the way. Cause
they know how to have a good time,
right?
Yeah.
Cause to them, all the bands that were playing in the Longapo was like, you know, like their connection home, because of course you remember
they're nostalgic.
A couple of thousand miles away from home, right?
Yes, exactly.
And so whenever they saw a band in a club and all that, that's why they always go to a club and get wasted and all that, because you know they feel like what they're looking at, watching, are the bands that.
They're imagining being back home, partying, having a good
time. Right, like Arkansas or something like that. Or
Black Oak, Arkansas?
Yeah, Black Oak.
Okay.
And then Allman Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
And then they had REO Speedwagon and all that. So, you know, the Longapo scene made them feel like they were home. And so that's how it went around, you know, until, of course, nature took its way, its course, and you know, flatten everything, you know, with Pinatubo, right?
Pinatubo,
yeah.
Everybody had to go home, party over.
Right, they had to give up.
But wait, let's go. How was Juan de la Cruz formed? When did that happen? How did that come about?
That came about the first Juan de la Cruz concert, Dodi Gonzalez, bless his soul, the brother of the Cuya of Wally, thought of, because that time there was this place called Mar de Plata. It was a actually it was a gambling place, you know. But what they did,
where
was
all good rock and roll comes from, Den of Sin, you know, that's where
the gambler.
Yeah, man, that's where we grew up.
Yeah, and they wanted to use the place because gambling was totally out of the question because, you know, martial law, right?
Yeah.
And so, you know, like they were thinking of what are we going to do with the millions we spend in this? It was a beautiful place, man. You know, it was all velvet from, you know, wall to wall velvet and all that.
Yeah.
Red velvet, man. And the stage was done pretty well, you know. And that was a time when Anak Bayan and the future Juan de la Cruz would you know, merge into one band. And, we used the Juan de la Cruz kind of thing, you know, like lightly, you know. And we did what, 3 or 4 months of, you know, like bashing the place with rock and roll and all that. And from that time, during our break, Dodi got us all together, me, Wally, and Mike, and said, you know what, you three, you know, like, I think you guys can do it on your own, man. You know, you don't need a big band or what, you know, like you can play drums and sing and, you know, this, blah, blah. And so I said, yeah, okay, that's a good idea and all that. Okay, let's record. Let's, you know, like put it in tracks, you know, a couple of tracks, you know, and all that. And then we'll have RJ promote it and all that. And so that's how we...
And who thought of the idea of, because until that time, nobody was singing, nobody was singing in Tagalog.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You guys were the first ones to start doing that, you know, let's sing in our own language. Who said, you know, let's do it this way? Was
me. Well, of course, you know, like...
Yabang mo naman.
Hindi. No, I'm just kidding. Ano magagawa ko? Ganun eh. Unless Wally came
joke
up
only,
with a...
Joke only.
Unless Wally came up with a vocal kind of thing, you know he doesn't sing, you know, he hates singing.
So you came up with it and you said, you know what, why are we going to sing in English? Let's start singing in our own language.
It came because of Dodi, the brother of Wally, thought of a concert, and he named it Himig Natin, okay? And that time, I was in Japan. Well, before I came, okay, back from Japan, I was already doodling with that chord. I mean, you know, the
for Himig natin.
Yeah, the first two riffs, you know, mm-hmm. and all that, and it was I was just humming, you know, like guttural, you know, like yeah. like, you know, just like that, because I didn't have the lyrics yet, and so when I came back, after a couple of months, Dolly came up with a plan to do a rock concert,
okay,
at Luneta.
Okay.
Okay.
And that's where it was written.
Okay. Yeah, right. And so that's where I wrote it at the CR. You know, like, okay, I was in.
What happened? You had this thing
I was
for
in
a
green
long
barrels.
Time.
Yeah.
You had this thing for a long time brewing in your head, and you
yeah,
said, you
chords.
Know what, we're going to do a concert.
The chords were just there.
I'm going to write parang the theme song of the
Yeah,
thing.
Right, right. Gonna, why right. not write this thing tonight? You know, like I said, yeah, why not? You know, like, I want everybody to remember this night that, you know, like, this is the first ever rock concert, the real thing, rock concert. We had the Downbeats and a couple of bands that played with us and all that. So, you know, the place was all, you know, like, blaring and, you know, like, noisy and all that. So I was going, shit, you know, what am I going to do? How? Where am I going to do this? You know, yeah. like, I need a little peace and sympathy and quiet, you know, and all that. So I walked around the... by the way, we did that at the observatory in Luneta, where mm-hmm. you know, like you have all the planets and all that.
Yeah.
That I remember, I was toying with the, you know, I attended one time, and you know, that time I was into star charts and all that, and you know, before the announcer would announce whatever constellation it was, I would go, oh, that's Sagittarius, you know.
I would say Sagittarius.
Oh, who's that, please? Yeah, because yeah. yeah, it was taking him a long time to describe what kind of stars there were, you know, and all that. Anyway, you know, and then I remember I walked down that area. The door was closed, you know, locked and all that. So I moved down to the CR, you know, I didn't want to take a leak. And I noticed the ladies... restroom was padlocked and all that, you know, like, but there's this, you can push it and all that, but you know, like, even they had to reroute the ladies into another location for that, and so, you know, like, I pushed it and it opened, and right behind me was this a good friend of ours, Egay Navarro, doing the film, and he filmed that. I don't know if he still has it.
Wow.
Well, that
there's classic
time, and,
footage.
You know, I was on yeah, I was on the verge of
special enhancement
program.
Kasangkapans. Yes, okay.
Anyway, I walked in there, had a flashlight, and then, you know, I just wrote the whole, you know, the whole
10
song.
10 minutes, right? It was like 10 minutes or something.
No,
5 minutes.
No. It was about I'd say 20-30 minutes.
Is there a story behind that song, or is it one of those songs wherein you want people to just get their own interpretation off of it?
Well, it's something like, you know, like from what's happening, the martial law thing, you know, like nobody wanted that, you know, like, and so I was trying to convey, you know, like,
that was what that was what this was in your mindset,
yeah,
the whole martial law thing, and,
you know, if I were you, shrug it off and just sing our own songs, you know, like, we will prevail. You know, like, there's no use fighting it with you know, weapons and all that. Like your sandata I heard a while ago.
Yeah.
You fight it with equality and justice and all that, instead of with the...
With weapons.
You know, your weapons,
the
you know, the
weapons,
kill, right?
Yeah.
Something like that. You know, how would I write it? How would I convey it or deliver it and all that? So that's it, you know, like, I was
all
alone.
It all just came out?
Yeah, and just, you know, like, then my creative juices were, you know, working for me that night. I was going, ooh la la, you know, thank you, Lord.
How does that feel for you? I mean, having a song that I think in every Filipino that's like a, you know, that's, it's like a, it's a growing up ritual that song is part of their life. You know, there comes a time in every Filipino's life where they hear that song and it becomes, you know, a lasting memory in them, that it's because it's got so much, you know, meaning and importance to it. And you wrote this song, and how does that feel?
Actually, you know, like, just like writing some other songs, you know, like, I didn't know that was going to happen that way. Yeah. But, you know, like, the message was there, like, hey, man, you know, like, it's no use, you know, like, to copy or to, you know, cover or what. We can do it our own, on our own. Yeah. We can, you know, like, flatten mountains, you know, flatten the mountains and all that, or you know, like reach the sky with this song, you know, like being original and all that, you know, like.
Just do it your own.
Yeah, right. Like, give yourself your identity and all that, you know, like being a true Filipino, you know, like sing it in Tagalog. What else?
Yeah. Diba? Yeah, exactly.
Even with the blaring guitars and all that, which is very Western, right? That's why it's Pinoy rock. You know, like, deliver it, you know, like, send it. Sealed and delivered, you know, with a bomb or
signed,
what?
Sealed, delivered.
Boom, diba? And I was, you know, like, it's only now that I feel it, cause way back then, you know, like, it's just an ordinary song.
It was
for
just
me.
Something you did.
Yeah,
at the time,
right. Like, so I'll do another one. I'll do another one. Do another one, until you know, like, thank you.
Yeah. Here's a question from at A Luke. They're asking, okay. From the Twitter thing, it's was it hard to be a rocker during the martial law era?
For me, no, because I never, you know, I had long hair down here, and I never got cut by these soldiers out in the streets, right? Because I was always hiding. Tago ko ng tago, you know. Nah, I don't want to go out, man. You know, I just want to stay in this house, this particular pad in Mariposa.
Yeah.
You know, that's where, you know, all the concoction coming from. You know, like when you're standing outside the house, man.
You can mix.
Yeah, you can see the house, man. You know, like
smoking.
No, man, not smoking.
Glowing.
Yeah, glowing. Different colors coming out of the, you know, roof and all that. And you know, I just, that time I didn't want to go out until, you know, like, it was announced that do not cut the hair, you know, and all that. Yeah. That's when I came out and, you know, like, enjoyed it then. Of course, it was awful and all that, but I don't know. It was always the music, the attitude that nobody can take it away from me. Nobody can change me. Because I'm doing this all by myself, you know, like for myself. It's not even for anybody, you know. But of course, you can't hide it. You can't hog it, you know.
You gotta share it.
You gotta share it, right? And to those who grooved on it, you know, like well,
pag
I
kung
hope
trip mo, cool.
Tira, di ba? And mo yeah. Enjoying mo, di ba? At maybe you know you'll get something out of it. Diba? I hope it's all the positive vibrations, because it came from my heart. You know, it came from my heart and my body.
Well,
electric.
Everything I gave but everything for.
Yeah. Enjoy, sit back, relax, forget about all that trouble outside the streets and all that, and do yourself a favor, man. You know, like you can transcend yourself somewhere in the skies, you know, like whatever constellation you can, you know, and all that, diba? Just to be free of everything.
And just immerse yourself, basically,
right,
in the thing
right,
you love,
right,
and the music you
right,
love and all that.
Right.
I think tonight is kind of like the definitive, man, Pepe Smith interview. We're learning a lot from you, and, you know, I am very happy. I hope everybody out there is happy too, man. Because this
feeling is mutual.
This is gold. This
rock
is really
roll.
Gold. All right. Can I ask you something? Did you expect when you first started with Juan de la Cruz? Did you expect it to be as big as it became?
Of course not. Man. You know, I never had even the faintest idea. You know, like I was just enjoying everything. You know, like
you're just doing it for the sake of doing it and having a good time. And
yeah. Just for the love of rock and roll, man.
Yeah.
You know, I never thought that, you know, it would come at this point. You know, like for me, it was just like just a a journey from way yo, you know, up to the the present right now.
Yeah.
And
it was just something you were doing.
Yeah, right. What God gave me, music. Because I found out that in my family tree, I am the first and foremost musician in the
whole lineage.
Yeah, right. Wow. Lineage, right. Yeah. And so, you know, like I said, well, I'm so glad. I'll be damned.
Do you ever regret it? Do you ever regret going into music? Do you ever look back and say, you know what, I wish I was a pilot, or I wish I was a doctor, or I wish I was...
Not anymore. Way back then, a little, you know, like... I still, you know, like, I still got time to, you know.
Yeah, I can catch up. I can do it all.
Yeah, right. Catch up, you know, like the time is with me, you know. Like, I got time on, time is on
still
my
on
side.
Still on your side.
Yeah. Time is on my side. Yeah.
Yes, it is. Okay. Sorry. Okay.
Woo! Why don't we just sing? No. Anyway, what happened was, of course, I wasn't in control of everything, but I just let it flow, man. You know, like, what else can I do?
Yeah.
Because if I, you know, like, if there
try
was
to
a counter,
control it or watch it or count or whatever, right, then it's not real. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. And I just let, you know, like, nature take its course.
When did it start picking up? When was it like, boom? When did you wake up and say, "Holy shit, we got something going on"?
That was in the 60s. Man, you know, when I...
I'm saying Juan de la Cruz. When did Juan
de la Cruz was about, you know, late 60s, early 70s. Mm-hmm. But even before that, you know, like I just, you know, like I committed myself to rock and roll.
Yeah. You sold your soul.
I sold my soul to rock and roll, man. Not to the devil.
Yeah.
Because I was born December 25.
That's right, yes.
Anyway, I told my, you know, like all I wanted to do was play, sing, you know, like no matter what happens, you know, like I'd be there, you know, to you know, sing for myself and to everybody. Because that's the only thing that I know that I can, you know, like, give myself a break and all that. Mm-hmm. You know, like, singing to...
There's no payment, like, a response of a crowd.
I never became a millionaire because, you know...
No, but I mean, Dubai, yeah, you know
what
I mean. In the same boat, man.
Yeah, in Dubai. Yeah. Yeah.
Utang up the ass. But, I mean, that's it, right? I mean, that's basically our number one reward is the...
Yeah.
The acceptance of the crowd. You know, when the crowd comes back to you and says, or when they start singing along with you. Like, what was the first time that a crowd actually was singing a song you wrote? Can you remember that? That first time when you were singing a song and you could stop at any point in that song and the crowd would just take over and sing?
I don't remember any, but during the early, you know why? Every time I played my songs, it would be different.
Yeah.
It would be a different arrangement and all that, or you know, like because... Remember, I was always with the new band because, you know, like when I quit Juan de la Cruz, I was on my own, and so I'd pick up musicians, you know, like in the street, you know, like on my way to whatever, you know, and so
really, it was like that. It was like, you're going to a gig. Anong ginagawa mo?
Imagine,
you know, to play. Sige, sama ka na. Ganun?
Yeah, ganun. Or you know, like do you know any of my songs? I said, oh, naman. So I was you know, like thinking, you know, like, my God, it was just like when I was starting, I had to know the songs of let's say Chuck Berry, or let's say I had to know how to play drums with the Ventures or the Shadows, or Muddy Waters songs and all that, you know. So this is what it is now, or the Beatles, right? Or all the bands that, you know, came out, because they were all my influences, you know. I can't say that it's only one. There's all of them, you know, all combined. That's why my music is all, you know, like, is a nervous wreck.
It's not one. I mean, we can say that your music is blues based. That is like the backbone of your music.
Yeah.
But it isn't
rock
blues.
And blues. Rock, yes. And blues. That's all
it's
that
like
meant.
Blues based. If you go back to the amoeba of it or whatever it is, it's a blues. But it's, you know, it's
nicely said.
It goes, yeah, diba?
Oh.
So, what the hell was I talking about? I lost my. Yeah, we were at Amoeba, and then
the music ata, hindi ba?
Yeah, there. Okay,
just
so
like
that's
me,
it.
I forgot.
It's like, so, but then you never stuck to the blues. I mean, because you were saying it's all this stuff.
Yeah,
that
all
comes
combined
in to make yes.
Yeah, because exactly. you can't say that, you know, like maybe I wasn't a particular a lead guitarist who'd pick on Clapton or Jimmy Page or this guy because.
A lot of times, that's like the fault of a lot of people is they'll pick one guy and they'll just emulate that guy to the ends of the earth, diba?
true.
As opposed to just, you know, getting inspiration
mismo,
from him.
Mismo. And they get stuck on that.
Yeah.
They get nailed there and that is the Waterloo of their career. Because it is because, like Eric Clapton once said, you know, like he, it was Elmer James, Robert Johnson. Well, Robert Johnson, he only announced only lately, because the guy was big already. Clapton, and then it was Robert Johnson and me. He only did it lately, you know, like because he's one of the only white blues guitarist that, you know, like the Blues Foundation of America really appreciated and all that.
Acknowledges.
And also Stevie Ray Vaughan, man.
Yeah.
My man. You know, I love that guy so much, man. You know, like,
when did you first discover Stevie Ray Vaughan?
Way back. His first album. He wasn't known then. It was called the Double Trouble.
Yes.
Not even Stevie Ray Vaughan and the Double Trouble. No, it was an album that they recorded with him. You know, like it was their very first album together. It was called Double Trouble.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then after that, they came out with
Stevie Ray Vaughan and Double Trouble.
Yeah. Right. And I was fascinated by this guy, man. You know, like he was the only lead guitarist in my life. You know, lifetime. That, you know, like. Every time I listened to him, man, you know, like, it almost got me to the edge of my seat, man, almost falling down, man, you know, like, man.
He just brings out emotions.
Yeah, right.
Okay, let's talk about Pinoy. I mean, you played with a lot of Filipino musicians. You played with some of the greatest Filipino musicians ever, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Has there been anybody like that, that played like that, that brought out the same emotions for you, you know?
Well, actually, there are about two of them. That's Jun Lupita and Wally Gonzalez. But of course, you know, like, they were, them, they
sip,
weren't
sip.
Only one guy.
Sip-sip.
Ah, syempre. Ano sip-sip? Higop. Big time ako eh. Higop.
Okay.
You know, like,
what you were saying, sorry.
Really, well, there are a couple of guys too around and all that, but I'm only discovering the young ones right now, and man, they're also, you know, the new blues guitarists right now, they're, you know, like getting into that, you know, how do you call this, that assault kind of thing, you know, like,
what do you mean, assault?
They know what they're doing.
Okay.
They know what they're doing, and way back then, you know, I never, you know, blues music is a no-no in Philippine musical circles. It has to be jazz, you know. And it got wiped out by rock and roll, you know, as we say. But actually, way back then, you know, like I was trying to connect with some blues players and all that. But it was only Wally and June that, you know, I was at home with. I'm not saying that, you know, there ain't nobody that could, you know, match them and all that. That's a different story. What I meant was maybe if they, you know, like I met them and all that, maybe we could have done something else that, you know, like could put them in front, right?
Yeah.
But right now, it was only those two that I felt at home with every time I played.
Is it that kind of connection wherein you guys get in the studio and they know what you're going to do and you know what they're going to do and everybody just understands each other? Is it
there
like
you
that?
Go. Yeah. Yes. You know, they know whatever, whenever I look there, they know what I'm I'm thinking about.
Yeah.
You know, like it was because of years of honing. You know, like we jam, you know, we do this, you know, just one whole afternoon, you know, like there's no particular song in the list. Just, you know, let's go, boom. We kind of explore chords,
yeah,
possibilities, how it would sound desafinado, you know, or sintonado, or what, you know, like that's why there are times when, you know, like a producer would call me up and say, can you put up a band tomorrow evening and all that? I said, yeah, I think I got the right band, this and that.
And you know the names now, it's that.
I called them up, and sometimes one or two of them can't make it because they have other bands to play with.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So I'm going, oh my God.
Shit, I can't pala.
Oh, and no, I have to say yes. And I try to look around and, you know, and I'm so glad. Maybe it's because, you know, like divine intervention, you know, like some, you know, like he sent somebody to me that is up and about, you know,
and
like
it works
like,
out. It always yeah. works out.
Yeah. But of course, I'm not perfect, man. You know, like there are times when, man, I wish I didn't play that night, you know, that gig. Yeah, pero, or, you know.
Well, everybody gets
yeah,
that, man.
Yeah, and you know, like I tell myself, well, it's not the end of the world yet, you know, like you can always.
Bawi na lang tayo bukas.
Andiba. Look tomorrow. Look at tomorrow, you know.
What was your most memorable gig as Juan de la Cruz? What, or maybe not even Juan de la Cruz. For you, what was the most memorable gig? I remember we had this roadie, Dino Barton.
Okay.
And he one time he talked about how there was a Juan de la Cruz concert and you came out wearing all white.
Yeah.
And it was like the first time, yeah, I guess in the Philippines somebody had seen, you know, somebody come out in all white and you had like things dangling and all this shit. And there was like a bonfire in the middle of the thing and you know, he was like blown away by that and it was so memorable to him that, you know, like years later he was still talking about it. What was your most, for you personally, you know, what was your most memorable gig? Was it that result?
I don't know how to say this, but every performance for me is
that's a canned answer, everybody. No, this is the most canned answer I've ever
I can't
heard
go back and think, you know, like if you give me a couple of days, I mean, you know, okay. You know.
Send us an email. Kasi, you know, Radio Republic.
Oh, naman, no. You know, like every
no,
time
I guess there's been so many, it's like, you know.
At saka, you know, like every time I go on stage, man, you know, like nothing can stop me. I mean, you know, like Dico may explain it. Basta, I give my all, you know, like I own the stage. I what else can I give?
Yeah.
What else can I give?
You're
but my
there,
music.
That's right.
That's why I can even now I'm trying to think very quickly, you know, like in nanoseconds or what, you know. Like,
yeah.
But cause all of them, even bad gigs.
Okay, how about there? Let's go. I love asking this question. Oh. Worst ever gig ever.
Okay, there was one that we
the
did.
The worst one, puede. The worst you could think of.
I told you, man.
Right.
Well, to me, it was the worst because the producer ran away with our money, you know,
that
didn't
sucks.
Pay us.
I hate that.
Ganon, di ba? Well, that's it. Like,
but aside from that, the music.
Even
wise,
that I enjoyed because what can I do?
Yeah.
What can I do? Shoot him? Kill him?
Yeah,
or what? You know?
What
the more
do?
They, you know, like. Bury me in jail, man.
All it'll do is hurt you if you think about it in a
masakit.
Negative way and all of that. You might as well just enjoy the moment and then, you know, live a longer
ka,
life.
Palagay ko naman, ang dami nangyari rin sa inyo, mga kaibigan, di ba?
Yeah, lahat tayo.
Pinramis kayo ng ganito, may kontrata pa, ganun. Pero bago matapos ang concert, mga 2 hours, biglang nawawala. Tiningay na lahat yung kaban ng gig.
Thank you na lang, thank you.
TY, di ba?
How about, what do you call it? Okay, how about this? What would you say was the lowest point in your life?
Oh, well, that again. Gee, Basti, you know, like, there's one thing that I always did to myself, and I taught myself how to do it. Enjoy everything that comes, you know, like, be bad or good, whatever, you know, like, you have to face it, man, you know, like, you got to be strong to face it, you know, and tell it off your face, you know, like, fuck you, you know. Yeah. You ain't going to get me, man, you know, because all I know is...
Whether it be the bed that you make or the bed that somebody else makes for you.
Or the broom that you sweep with.
Yeah. Just ride it. It's basically what you're saying. Just have as much fun with it whatsoever.
Right, right. Because I couldn't do anything about it, man. Yeah. If I owed somebody, I have to pay for it, man.
That's right.
If I did somebody wrong, I have to, you know, apologize, right? And I hate apologizing because, you know, like, you know, like, you know, like, what are you yelling about, you know? but of course, you know, like, I do once in a while because I know I'm wrong.
Is there anything that you've regretted doing so much?
Oh, not at all, not at all. No. I cannot look back anymore, you know, like, all I want to do is, you know, like, sit back, you know, and enjoy myself, you know, with that and this and doing that.
Yeah.
What else?
What else can you do?
Diba? Yeah. Ano ba gagawa ko?
What would you say is your personal time? What do you do when you're not playing music?
Woo! I'm busy with my Xbox and my PS3 and
video game. Can somebody connect him with Mon and Manuel and Diablo 3? And then, you know?
No, I'm sure I'm going to lose. I'm going to lose because, you know, like, I'm just... Oh, I love it. I love it.
Okay. Here's my next question. And this is something that I've noticed ever since. And it's kind of, you know, it's kind of been pretty... I find it really galing. I know a lot of people in the industry, and these are, like, some of the greatest musicians that I've ever had the pleasure of seeing live and knowing and you know... I'm talking like Chico Ipura, Jun Lupito, Miguel Ortigas, even Eli Buendia.
Yeah.
These guys look up to you at some level that's like, you know, I mean, when they talk about you, it's not normal. It's like, you know,
abnormal.
As in, no, abnormal. No, parang, you know, they you can really see the respect and the love, which is an important word that they have for you, right? What is it, do you think, about you that inspires people that way? What is it that brings out this, you know, feeling?
You know what, Basti? It beats me, man. Like, it is because probably, you know, like, I'm still alive, you know, and still kicking and all that. But it was, I really don't know because...
you feel that, right? You see it. You know it. You know
because
that
every one of them, every one of them, all the young dudes, okay? What? I'm 64. They're all my children, you know? I don't want to add you, but you're my children.
Sakit naman. Bakit naman? Why am
you're my special children. Dami mo, ha? Plural. Plural yun, pare, children. Ayan. The most abnormal child. Just like that, man, you know. I know, again, I ask, how else do you want me to accommodate all these people, to, you know? That's all I know.
You just take everybody
you said,
in.
What you just said to me, you know, like, I'm deeply honored and all that, with, you know, like, of course, I never thought of that, you know. Because some way... you know, they're much better guitar players than I am. Okay? I can say this because I know myself. I'm only a rhythm guitarist, a little slider, and a vocalist. Okay? I leave the rest to Wally, like if only Manuel was here, you know, Manuel Garda, yeah, and all that, to all the lead guitarists, because Jun Lupito, whoever, you know, because that's their job. My job is to sing, play, and rock the place out. That's all I know.
That's it, yeah.
Right? That's why I never even thought that that's how they look up at me, you know, like, to me. Wow. I'm so glad.
Okay, next question.
After all these years, man, you know, like, because I respect them too so much, because they are also good players and all that. They never let me down every time we jammed and all that.
Yeah.
They're all great too, you know. Yeah.
Okay, it can be said that you're the face of Pinoy rock. You're a big part.
Can I smoke?
Twinkie. Holy shit.
Twinkie.
No to Pepe.
Twinkie.
Right, everybody out
this
there.
This is the only
Twinkie
place that
I've said no to Pepe. Okay, let's go.
I'll send my jet fighters, man. We need my raptors here.
It can be said that you're a big, you know, you are the face of Pinoy rock, right? You're a big Ooh, part.
This face?
Yes. It's a great face, man.
Think twice, ladies and gentlemen, before you.
But I mean, you were a big part of starting it. I mean, if not the person that started it, you know, you and your contemporaries. But what can you say about where it is now, with regards to the music and the industry? You look at all of this, you know, which is something basically you gave birth to. And where it's gone, or where it's gotten to from where it started, what do you say about it? I mean,
what else can I say? But, you know, like, rock on, because you can't.
Are you proud of it? Are you happy
Very. I'm happy because I'm still, you know, like included in all that, you know, like, of course, I'm very happy because, man, you know, like bands pop out, you know, like left and right, you know, like, and it's not gonna stop, you know, as long as they're the teens, man, the young at heart, you know, like the heartbeat is always rock and roll, man, mm-hmm. or you know, go over that, you know, but it's always rock and roll, because you can't have a heart of, you know, steel or what, you know,
yeah.
You have to go through rock and roll first, you know. That's how I assess everything, you know, like. I'm so glad that it's the kind of music that really, you know, like embedded in me and all that, and I'm so glad that people really enjoy it, because there's nothing wrong with it.
Yeah.
Because this rock and roll gave all the other new music that's coming out, rap, hip hop.
Hardcore, Cookie Monster,
name it.
Yeah.
You know, you always have to go back to rock and roll. Rock, you know.
And rock it's something that you're happy with. You think that the way it's gotten to,
I have
when
to
it's
be happy.
And
I have to be happy, Basti. Because there's nothing else, you know, like every time I see them, you know, like they all come to me and, you know, like, woo, like I said, they're all my children.
Yeah.
And that's one thing that I you know, keeping myself, you know, like if call me selfish or what, you know, like, but it never comes out in my head, you know, it's not in my head, it's always in my heart. In this age, man, you know, like, I don't know how, you know, I can still do it and all that, you know, like, probably
actually,
a little of this.
That's okay, let's wrap this stuff off, because shoot,
why?
I want a cigarette and you want a cigarette.
Yeah, but
and this is like the longest show we've ever had. It's like a 2.5 hour show. But
why? How long it should be?
Well, no, I don't know. It's you. I just want to smoke. That's all I want. We can come.
Well,
back
we can
and
smoke
some
too,
more, man.
Yeah,
we'll do all of that.
But ladies and gentlemen, what he's trying to convey is we're going to smoke this,
yeah.
Not whatever you're thinking. Huh?
It's the
don't ever accuse us of doing all that, you know, like nasty stuff.
You bastards.
Yeah. We'll get you one of these days.
Peps, let me just ask you, did you ever think you were going to... You're how old did you say you were? You're 63.
I'm sorry, I take that back.
You're 62. 61. 56.
No.
Shall we go lower? 45. 40. Magka edad tayo? 39. 22? Okay, you're 22 years old, Peps. Did you ever think you were going to be doing it this long, man? When you started this, did you say, you know what? I'm going to be doing this thing. You're going to do this till the day you die, right?
Right, right.
Did you ever think you were going to do this?
All I know is, you know.
And okay, follow up. Do you ever get tired of it?
Sometimes. Some songs.
Some songs, yeah.
Some of my songs, you know, my own songs. Do I have to do this for the nth time, you know? Diba? But as long as they're, you know, asking for it, you know, like, I'm going to give it to them. Right?
And, it's all about the people in there.
Yeah,
the
right, right. First of all, are my fans.
Yeah.
Because no matter what, if not for them, I wouldn't be here.
That's right.
They're the ones who put me here. Yes, so right. I have my obligations that I should, you know, give it back to them.
Yes.
Yeah. And also, like Brian, my manager, BM, you know, like, once he told me, you know, like, he asked me, like, hey, Peps, what can we do, right? Should we be together and you know, like, paint that road to rock and roll and all that?
Okay.
I said, wow, thanks for asking me, man. The answer is, let's do it.
Yeah.
Because nobody else did. I never had a manager like that, you know.
That
like,
asked you.
Nothing, man. You know, like, oh, they had all these groups. They were so lucky because nowadays all they had to do is pick up a guitar and play, man, you know, like garage or what, you know. Somebody's taking their video and all that, and they get, you know, promoted right away. We did it the hard way. You know, we had to, you know, like blood, sweat, and tears, man, you know, like really ooze out of us. And that's why I always thought, you know, like it's not saying that, you know, like, it's not even that much that what we've done is what, you know, like happening now. Mm-hmm. But for me, as long as everybody rocks, you know.
Has a good time.
Have a good time and enjoy. Remember, always enjoy what you do. Always be happy. That's all you got to do. That's what I did, man. I don't know if it's going to, you know, like happen to you and all that, but... No matter what, man, you know, like, be happy with what you do. Just don't hurt. Don't hurt at all, okay?
On that note, everybody, that's it for us, man. This has been the, sir, thank you so much again, man.
Rock and
thank
roll.
You so
Rock
much. I think, I don't think we could get much more information from that, man. That's the most awesome. What are you going to do? Is there something you got to read over there? Or?
Wait, where's my glasses? Where are my glasses? Oh, yeah.
Everybody like who stayed, who stuck around, who watched the show, thank you so much, man.
And salamat po.
We'll see you guys next week for another episode of Rock Bato. Pepes, sir, thank you again so much, man.
Thank you, Basti. And you too, and the whole gang in here, the Radio Republic. At,
Rock Republic.
Oh, nga, yeah, no? Yeah, Rock Republic.
It. Rock Republic.
Oh, nga, eh.
Rock
sa
Republic.
Tagalog,
PH.
Bato Republika.
Oh, ibato ang Republika. Ibato ang Republika.
Mga kaibigan, maraming salamat po. At huwag kayong mag-alala. Basta enjoy nyo yung ginagawa nyo. Huwag kayong aapak sa mga ibang tao. Huwag kayong mananakit. Enjoy nyo lang yan. Buhay nyo, rock and roll yan. Ito ang mga susunod na... magiging guest po dito. September 23, Wally Gonzalez. Hindi, ito pala, sorry, hindi ko na isuot. Ang yabang ko eh. Sorry, ang yabang ko. Kala ko suot ka na, hindi pala. Wally Gonzalez and Dos Mestizos Boracay. Sa puto. Kaming dalawa yun. Kaming dalawa yun. Dos Mestizos. Ay! Sa Boracay po yun sa September 23. Ngayon, kung di kayo makakapag-Boracay, eh, dyan na sa mga bathtub, pwede na. So September 28th.
Walang lumot.
Oh, di ba? Okay, so September 28th, Oktoberfest, MOA. MOA. You know what MOA is?
Mall of Asia. Schumart.
Kala ko motivation.
Motivation.
anyway. September 30, Juan de la Cruz Band sa Boiler Room. Kaya lang, bili kayong ticket papuntang Singapore.
Madali lang yan. Dalawang bus ride lang yan. Oh, tapos isang jeep ride. Tapos
it's just a swim away, man.
Yeah, that's right.
September 30 po, Juan de la Cruz sa Singapore, Boiler Room. Tapos October 5, Juan de la Cruz po sa Green Hills sa Sessionistas. Tapos October 20, Juan de la Cruz band again. Ba, ang dami nito ah. I thought we were dead. So, it's the year of the living dead.
Mga zombies.
Juan, di ba? Zombies. Juan de la Cruz, Super Sessions, live, Hard Rock Cafe, Makati. We're conquering Makati now. Makati, you know.
All right, everybody, that's it. Hey, next week, don't forget, Urban Dub is going to be on with us. So that's going to be a great show, man. Pepe, thank you so much
again.
I didn't get to read the gig list for this week, but check it out. It'll be posted on the RadioRepublic.ph Facebook. Yeah. Facebook page. All right. Everybody, thank you so much. Pepe, thank you so much. What a great
rock and roll
show, man.
Keep rocking, Basti. Keep rocking. Putanginan mismo.
All right, everybody. We're going to end the show with a video from a band called Pupil, who I'm sure you guys are all familiar with. Here's the song, 2020. Have a good fucking evening.
2020, that's 40.
You guys. That's 40. 40. 40. 40. 40.